Brian Kinchen had played in the NFL for 13 years, and still he felt like a failure. Then 3 years after he left football, Brian got the second chance of a lifetime.
Brian Kinchen was a 38-year-old husband, father of four, and a seventh grade Bible school teacher. Then in December of 2003, the hottest team in the NFL called, the New England Patriots. The NFL playoffs were only a few weeks away, and the Patriots needed someone to snap the ball for their punter and kicker. Just 7 weeks later, Brian was the long snapper in the dramatic Super Bowl-winning field goal by Adam Vinatieri.
Please welcome to the 700 Club, Brian Kinchen. Brian, it's great to have you here.
Well, thanks for having me.
Does your heart still kind of pound as you watch that video?
It does. Every time I watch it, it's the same emotions, but fortunately I know the outcome. So.
Yeah, it's an amazing story. You played in the NFL for 13 years. That's a dream of most little boys' hearts, and yet you felt like a failure at the end of that. Why?
Well, I was always a performance-based affirmation guy. I never felt good enough for some reason. I always felt like I needed to do more, I needed to be better. And, you know, when you dream growing up to be an NFL star and you're fortunate enough to get that career, you know, you just, I guess this is human emotion. You always just want more. And so it's a feeling I still deal with today. It's no different than it was then. So
you left the NFL. Now you're in a teaching position. And what was it, 4 years after you left, you get a phone call while you're teaching a junior high class. Tell us about that.
Well, yeah, it was 3 years after I'd retired. Okay. And, you know, I'm 38 years old, father of four. I'm with a wife that God hand-selected for me, and just in a place I felt like I was supposed to be, teaching seventh grade Bible. And so the New England Patriots call me, and I'm sitting there thinking, football, there's just no way that you're actually asking me to come back. So I was wasn't very sure if I wanted to go, but obviously everybody that I talked to said I should. And when I found out that they were 12-2,
yeah,
I changed my mind.
I was going to say, good team choice.
Right. So I took the opportunity, and it turned into a seven-week odyssey of it was just unbelievable.
It was unbelievable.
Right.
Talk a little bit about the position of snapper for people who aren't football fans. What does the snapper do, and why is that position so pivotal?
It's unusual in the sense that you're very unnoticed, and you have to basically throw a football upside down with 300-pound guys standing over you waiting to annihilate you. So,
yeah, I'd never thought of it quite that way.
Yes, it's very, very unique, and not many can do it and do it well, but now there's 32 of them in the NFL who get paid quite a bit of money to do it. In fact, my son is one at
LSU.
No
kidding.
Yes.
Wow. So here you are, you're one day in the classroom as a teacher, and the next day you are back in the NFL with the top contender. What kind of psychological culture shock was that?
It was very surreal. I remember when Bill told me that I'd made the team and that I was going to be back, and it's something I wanted to do for so long. I wanted to be back because I didn't feel like I was ready to walk away.
Yes.
And I had dreams about it time and time again, and it was just so funny because that dream became a reality of walking into that meeting room for the first time with a bunch of guys I didn't know.
Yeah.
And I was back to where I wanted to be in the NFL, and it was an unbelievable feeling. And then to be able to end it the way it did was obviously icing on the cake. So.
Will you talk a little bit? You mentioned the 7 weeks leading up to the moment we saw in the big game, and the last, was it 9 seconds, I believe, at the end of that game. But talk about those 7 weeks, because, you know, it was the dream of a lifetime to go back and have that second chance, but there had to be incredible pressure on you to make this count.
Yeah, and it almost turned into a nightmare in a sense, because the confidence that I had going into that tryout and going back was as good and as it had ever been. But it was funny how in those 5 weeks, which I did fairly well, but when we got ready for Super Bowl week, which was, it was a two-week process, I just began to do things and throw snaps that I just had never done before. And so all my confidence was slowly being eroded through the process. But God had a plan in the midst of it all, which I was not really oblivious to and not real happy about.
As you were going through those last 2 weeks and you were getting ready and you felt like your snap was a little bit off and the ball wasn't going where you wanted it to, what was going through your mind? I mean, how did you keep your heart and your mind in the right place?
Well, I just kept asking God why. I just didn't understand because I felt like I was where I needed to be teaching.
Yeah.
And then I got the call, I prayed about it, felt like that's where I needed to go. And then I'm there and I'm in this torment of not being able to do what I'd done so well for so long, not even without a thought, and going into the biggest stage of all professional sports. And so I couldn't see the end as God did. And I just had to understand that God had a plan, there was a reason, and certainly it was revealed at the end.
You know, you went into teaching after you'd left the NFL, and sometimes we make a decision based on, you know, what we feel our calling is, but you had a lot of unresolved issues about your athletic career.
Right.
Did you really appreciate the opportunity in the teaching thing until after you had a chance to go back and do the football again?
I think it gave me certainly an added perspective, but for me, once my career ended and my success part of my life I felt was over, then it was a shift to significance. And so what other way is there to impact the world than through young people and teaching and coaching?
So did going back to teaching then have a whole new perspective for you once you'd had this second chance?
I think it did. It did, but I'd always known that my career, or even a game like that wouldn't change who I was. It wouldn't make me any different. But the beauty of it was that I got to experience the reality of being a part of the greatest championship in all of football, and to be able to see the reality that, you know what, it doesn't make a difference. There is nothing at the end of the rainbow that should change me, because if my feet are firmly planted in the Word of God and I understand who I am in His eyes, that nothing should change that.
You know, what we haven't mentioned here that we should mention is not only was this the opportunity of a lifetime, not only did you get picked up by the team to be picked up by, but in that final game, you were playing the Carolina Panthers, the very team that had cut you.
Right.
What kind of pressure did that put on you?
It was ironic, but I don't know that I felt vengeful, because if I surely commit to that God has a plan for my life, I can't really hold people accountable, because it's what He wanted to happen and the way He wanted it to work out. So it was really amazing that it ended like that. It just kind of adds to the story that really wrote itself pretty much.
Will you talk about those moments of that game? I mean, as you're sitting on the sideline, I mean, here you are, you're in the Super Bowl, for heaven's sakes, in this second shot at the whole thing. When did you realize that the whole thing was going to fall into your lap and count on your skill?
I was trying to avoid that. I prayed all week that God would not allow that to happen, because I was so depleted of everything that I had. And the amazing thing about it was, as I talked about, God had stripped away all the confidence I had. And so I going out there, it's almost surreal in retrospect, because I had no confidence of being able to get that football where it needed to go. And I told my father right when that play was over, right when that game was over, that I felt like Gideon, because God, like He did with Gideon, stripped away all of his army down to 300 guys so that Israel couldn't take credit for it. And so I told him I felt the exact same way, because I have no stake or no claim to be able to say that it was me that got that ball back. It was only by the grace of God that ball got where it did, and we ended up winning that football game.
Yeah, that was an incredible moment. Let's take a look at your Super Bowl ring. I mean, I feel like I need to come over there with the forklift and lift your hand up so we can look at this.
Yeah, the ring is a great, great symbol, and everybody talks about getting the ring. And for me, the ring obviously is a wonderful reward for what we're able to be a part of, but I think the beauty of it is that it gives me a platform unlike anything else to be able to go and to share the message of the story and my faith.
And what are you doing today?
Just trying to get used to teaching and getting in the routine again, because I'd kind of been on my own for a while, trying to, you know, obviously traveling and speaking about the experience. And this book that we've been working on for the last year has been consuming us, because it's a message that it transcends all areas of life, and it's a great sports narrative, and then the element of what I was going through and the way that God used that to enlighten me. It was just incredible.
It is another amazing picture of the fact that our God is the God of a second chance, and that He uses us when we least expect it in amazing ways. The book about Brian Kinchen's life is called The Long Snapper, and I love the secondary title, A Second Chance, A Super Bowl, A Lesson for Life. This is available wherever books are sold. It is an incredible story. Thank you so much
I appreciate
for coming
you having
and
me.
Sharing. It's
Thank you so much.
Wonderful. We're going to be back with more of the 700 Club right after this.